Hello everyone and welcome to my video lecture. So today we are going to start with the last part of evolution, and that is based on human evolution, right? In our last lecture, we had completed the modern synthetic theory of evolution, and we had completed with natural selection, and we had completed isolation, right? So let us start with our today's part, which is called as human evolution. All right. Now, for the board exams, this part is not very, very important. All right, questions are asked, but for the students who are giving CET or NEET, this is a very, very important part, and it's very, very theoretical. So you'll have to remember quite a few number of things. Okay, and I will tell you what the important parts are as we go ahead. Now, let us start with human evolution. Now, it is said that the human evolution began approximately 54 to 65 million years ago. Okay, so 54 to 65 million years ago. Now, million years ago is written as MYA. Okay, so please remember that is the abbreviation for million years ago. So that is when the evolution began. And the epoch, the time frame where that evolution began, that is called as the Paleocene epoch. Paleocene epoch. Now, all the people who are studying from the state board, please remember that in your book, the spelling of Paleocene is given as Paleocene. Okay, so the spelling is given as Paleocene. That is the wrong spelling. It is Paleocene. Okay, so please make that correction. Now, what is the meaning of epoch? Okay, so the time frame, when we talk about evolution, the time frame is divided into three basic parts. Okay, so what I will do is I will just write down them. Okay, we will just rub this off for a brief moment. So the time frame is divided into three parts. The first part is called as an era. All right, the next part is called as a period, and the third part is called as the epoch. Are you getting this point? Now, out of these three, which of them is the smallest time frame? The smallest is epoch. So you can say that many different epochs together form one period, and many periods together form one era. Is this clear? Now, evolution of human beings began in the era which is called as Cenozoic era. All right, the period which is there under Cenozoic era is called as Tertiary period. All right, and the epoch, which is the most important, is called as Paleocene epoch. Are you getting the point? So basically, this is when the human evolution started. So please remember, human evolution, apes evolution, monkey evolution, everything has started in this Paleocene epoch, and that is approximately 54 to 65 million years ago. Is this clear? Okay, now let us start with the human evolution. Okay, now what I'm going to draw is, I'm going to just draw a flowchart which is showing the diversification of class Mammalia. Okay, so I'm going to show a branch tree structure of flowchart which will help you to understand how we have evolved, how the monkeys have evolved, how the apes have evolved. So let me make the flowchart. So I will start with the class Mammalia over here. All right, now this class Mammalia is further divided into three subclasses. Okay, so the first subclass under Mammalia is called as Metatheria. Now, Metatheria subclass, these organisms are also called as marsupials. Okay, now what are marsupials? Marsupials are all the mammals which have a pouch to carry their young one. For example, kangaroo. Okay, so again, all the people who are studying from the textbooks, this word Metatheria is not given in the textbook. It is just for your understanding. The name of the subclass is Metatheria. In your book, marsupials must be given. It's the same thing. Okay, so marsupials are all the organisms or all the mammals having pouches to carry the young ones. Then coming to the second subclass, after Metatheria, the second one is called as Protheria. Okay, and these are also called as monotremes. This is the word that you will find in the textbook. Now, monotremes are all egg-laying mammals. See, mostly mammals are not egg-laying. Okay, they are viviparous. That is, they give birth to the young ones. But some of the mammals are egg-laying mammals. For example, platypus duck-billed. You must have heard of that organism. So, all the organism, all the mammals which are egg-laying, they come under this Protheria. And the third subclass under Mammalia is called as Eutheria, and Eutheria are all the mammals which are having a placenta. Okay, so in these mammals, the mother and the fetus are connected with the help of a placenta, so you can call them as placental mammals. Is this clear? Okay, so this is the further diversification of class Mammalia. We are talking about the subclasses now. Out of these three, we are concerned with human evolution, monkey evolution, or ape evolution. So we are going to basically go ahead and we are going to continue with Eutheria. Please remember this. Now, Eutheria is further divided into many different orders. Okay, but we are concerned with our evolution, so we are going to begin with order primates. Please remember this. This is a very important thing, because from here we are going to basically diversify the evolution, and we are going to show how the monkeys have evolved, how the apes have evolved, and how the human beings have evolved. Is this clear? So that is why what I'm going to do is I'm going to just put this in a box, because this is very important. Now, order primates is further divided into two suborders. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to draw this over here. One of the orders, suborders, which is present is called as Prosimi, Prosimii. So this is again a suborder. So I am writing over here, suborder Prosimi. Okay. And the other suborder which is there is called as suborder Anthropoidea. Are you getting this? Okay, so suborder Prosimi, suborder Anthropoidea. Now, suborder Prosimi has got many different organisms. Two of the examples under Prosimi are lemurs. Okay, and the other example of organisms are called as tarsiers. Now, please remember, if you know about these organisms, they may look like monkeys, but they are not actually monkeys. Okay, so you can say that they are precursor to the monkeys. Are you getting my point? All right, now, so Prosimians are not basically monkeys. They might look like monkeys, but they are not monkeys. Now, coming to suborder Anthropoidea, again, this is a very important suborder, because from here basically we are going to show how the monkeys and apes and human beings have been formed. So again, I am circling this suborder. Now, this suborder Anthropoidea is further divided into three groups. Okay, so the first group is going to be something which is called as New World monkeys. All right, the second group is going to be called as Old World monkeys, and the third group is going to be called as Homo Noidea. Okay, now, so here you can see that the monkeys have been formed. So monkeys have been divided into two categories, Old World, New World. I will explain all this. First, let me complete the chart. Homo Noidea is very important, because this group consists of apes and mammals. So this is a very important part for us, Homo Noidea. Now, this Homo Noidea is further divided into three parts. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to just scroll down a bit. Okay, now Homo Noidea is further divided into, So now again, let me just make this flowchart. The first group is called as Hyalobatidae. All right. The second group is called as Pongidae. And the third group is called as Hominidae. All right. And I'm again going to circle this Hominidae because all the humans are present in this group. So guys, now let us just again go back to the classification. Okay. So we had got class Mammalia. We have class Mammalia. Class Mammalia is divided into three subclasses: Metatheria, Protheria, Eutheria, as I've already shown. Now Eutheria, placental mammals, further divided into many orders. One of them is order primates. So you should know the classification from this part. Okay, this part from order primates, it is very, very important. Order primates is further divided into suborder Prosimi and suborder Anthropoidea. So Prosimi has got two examples. So two of the mammals, lemurs, tarsiers, they are not monkeys. They look like monkeys, but they are not. Suborder Anthropoidea, very, very important. Okay, suborder Anthropoidea, further divided into three parts: New World monkeys, all right, Old World monkeys, and Hominoidea. Now, what are New World monkeys? What are Old World monkeys? So basically, all the monkeys, both these groups, New World and Old World, they developed together. But the thing is, initially most of the monkeys were present in Africa. And then some of the monkeys from Africa, they migrated to South America. Okay. And the monkeys which migrated from Africa to South America, they are called as New World monkeys. It is not that the Old World monkeys originated first, then the New World monkeys came. It's not like that. Both of them came at the same time. However, the monkeys which migrated from Africa to South America, they are called as New World monkeys. Okay, obviously the physical features, attributes of New World monkeys and Old World monkeys are also different. For example, New World monkeys have got something which is called as a prehensile tail. Okay, now what is the meaning of a prehensile tail? A prehensile tail, okay, let me just rub this off. Okay, so a prehensile tail is a tail which is highly muscular. Okay, so that tail can be used for grabbing the branches or grabbing the trees. That is called as a prehensile tail. It can be used as an extra limb. So the tail is long and it is muscular. Whereas the Old World monkeys have a weak tail. So they cannot use the tail for support and the tail is shorter. Okay, so Old World monkeys do not have a prehensile tail. So if you want, I will write down over here non-prehensile tail. Is this clear? The other thing is, even the nose structure is different. Okay, the Old World monkeys have a flat snout, New World monkeys have a narrow snout. So there are many differences between these two. So please remember, both of them evolved together, and the migration of the New World monkeys from Africa to South America took place around 40 million years ago. Okay, now this migration details which I am telling you, this is all extra information. It is not given in your textbooks, so don't try to find it there. Just wanted to you to know that they are both actually more or less very, very similar. They are not evolving at different times. They have evolved together. And also remember that the apes, okay, so the monkeys or the primates which are closest to human beings are called apes. So apes were also staying in Africa along with the Old World monkeys. So simultaneously, you can say that Anthropoidea gave rise to three different organisms. So first class was New World and Old World monkeys. Then it gave rise to apes and it also gave rise to humans. Okay, so apes and Old World monkeys were living together. Now coming to Hominoidea. Okay, now Hominoidea is the group where apes and man are basically placed. Now coming to the first two words under Hominoidea, alright, the first one is Hyalobatidae. Hyalobatidae are basically all arboreal apes. What are arboreal apes? Arboreal apes means, arboreal means tree dwelling. Okay, and these are small sized apes, please remember. Normally when we think of apes, we think that they are huge in size. We think of gorilla, we think of chimpanzee, but arboreal apes are all small in size. They are completely tree dwelling. Example, if you want, examples are gibbons, G-I-B-B-O-N-S. Next, we come to the group called as Pongidae. Now, these are semi-arboreal apes. So what do you mean by semi-arboreal? So semi-arboreal means that tree dwelling and also terrestrial. And these are large size apes. Please remember this. Okay, they are large sized. So the apes belonging to this category are chimpanzee, right? Then gorilla and also orangutan. You can always go on the net and search for this word. You will come to know how the organism looks. Okay. And finally, coming to the most important group out of all these three, hominidae. And this is where human beings are placed. Okay. So human beings are basically placed in this category of hominidae. So are you clear? So if somebody asks you, can you classify hominidae right from class mammalia? Then how are you going to do that? We are going to start with class mammalia first. Then subclass Eutheria, then order primates, then suborder Anthropoidea, then under suborder Anthropoidea, Homonoidea, under Homonoidea, Hominidae, and that is where human beings are grouped. Alright, guys, so this is the classification part. I hope it is clear. Okay, it is not very, very important from the exam point of view. From NEET and CET point of view, it is important. From the board's point of view, it is not important. Now, going ahead, see what happened was mostly apes and man, they were closely related. Okay, for example, if you see the DNA of a chimpanzee and if you compare it with DNA of human beings, there is only 2.5% difference between the two DNAs. Just imagine. So 97.5% of DNA present in chimpanzees and human beings is the same. However, if you compare the DNA of monkeys and human beings, then the difference is more. 10% approximate difference is present in the sequence of nucleotides of DNA. So you can see that apes are much more closer related to human beings compared to monkeys. All right. Now, what are the differences between ape and man? Okay. So what we are going to do is we are just going to scroll down. Okay. What are the differences between ape and man? Or the question can be asked, how is man much more evolved compared to apes? Okay, so special characters of man, if we want to write down over here, all right, when we compare them to apes, then these characters can be, first of all, the first function we can write down as the cranial capacity. Okay, what is the meaning of the cranial capacity? Cranial capacity means volume of the brain or the size of the brain. So the cranial capacity in human beings is much higher compared to the cranial capacity of apes. Obviously, the brain is much more developed. Okay, so I will write down over here, brain more developed. Okay, so because of a higher developed brain, intelligence is also more, okay, then motor skills, we can say motor skills, running, okay, all the muscles that you use, so they are performing the motor skill. Okay, then speech, you can write down language formation, speech. So I will write down over there. So in all these aspects, human beings are much more developed compared to the apes. Then coming to some of the physical aspects, you can say that human beings are bipedal. What is the meaning of bipedal? Bipedal mean human beings use only two limbs for walking. So we use both our hind limbs. Do we use our four limbs for walking? No. However, if you compare this with the apes, apes use all the four limbs for walking. They use the four limbs also, they use the hind limbs also. The apes are quadrupedal, whereas human beings are bipedal. Then coming to the limbs, in the case of human beings, four limbs are shorter. All right. Whereas hind limbs are longer. Please remember this. Okay. And in the case of apes, it is opposite. If you see the apes, apes have longer forelimbs and shorter hind limbs. Okay, then development of an opposable thumb. Opposable thumb is the thumb which helps you to do many things. You can see that the thumb is opposable. Are you getting this? Okay. Then many other features which are present which distinguish us from apes. For example, our posture is erect. Okay. Whereas if you see the apes, the posture is always semi-erect because they are always bent. Okay. If you see an ape walking, you can see that they are bending their spine and walking. So the posture is semi-erect. Whereas we are walking with a straight spine. So it is erect posture. Then coming to the curvature of the spine, okay, so you must be knowing that there is cervical curvature, lumbar curvature. Then in the case of human beings, lumbar curvature is present in the spine, whereas in the case of apes, the lumbar curvature is absent. Please remember this, okay. Then any other thing, pelvic girdle. The pelvic girdle in the case of humans, the pelvic girdle is broad. Okay, it is much more broader, whereas in the case of apes, the pelvic girdle is narrower. Are you getting this? So there are many such points. Okay, and with the help of these points, we can actually say that human beings are much more developed compared to the apes. Okay, in the case of intelligence, okay, in the case of certain physical aspects such as the forelimbs, the hind limbs, the locomotion, the posture, okay, then certain parts. One more point that I remembered, which is not given in the book, okay, chin is present. All right, the chin is present in human beings, whereas in the case of apes, chin is absent. And if you see the skull of the human beings, okay, if you see a human being from sideways, then the skull is actually not sloping, it is just going down straight, vertically downwards. Whereas if you see the skull of the ape from sideways, then you see that it is sloping ahead. So if you see, I will just draw it over here. If you see the skull of the human beings from sideways, it is going downwards vertically. So the eyes, the nose and the mouth, everything is in this straight line. Whereas if you see the skull of the ape, it is forward directing. If you see this part of the ape, it is coming forward. So the skull which is coming forward or which is protruding, it is called as a prognathous face. Prognathous means it is protruding forward, whereas orthognathous means it is in the straight line. So I will write over here orthognathous skull present in the case of human beings. Okay, prognathous means it is protruding forward, which is in the case of it. So more than enough points we have jotted down, and in all these aspects we can see that we as human beings are much more developed compared to apes. All right, so now let us come to the main part of this chapter, and that is going to be the evolution of man. Okay, how has man evolved? There were many stages in evolution. So we are currently called as Homo sapiens sapiens, right? But the evolution began, and the stages, which were the initial stages, those stages looked much more like monkeys. So when we talk about hominidae, okay, the first initial stages, the organism or the mammal looked just like monkeys. Then slowly there was, so the first stages can be called as ape stage. Then slowly the organism became man-like, so the stage is called as ape-man stage. Then the ape characters were removed, and then became the stage where human beings began to look like us, and that was called as the man stage. All right, so let us start with those stages of evolution. All right, and I have got a chart over here with me, and we are going to make use of this chart to study the human evolution. Is this clear? Now again, very theoretical, okay, not important from the board exams point of view, but important from your NEET or CET point of view. Now first of all, I will tell you what this chart is. Okay, so if you can see the first column, which is the first row, which is present. Okay, so here you can see the names of the stages: Dryopithecus, all right, then Ramapithecus, Australopithecus, Homo habilis, Homo erectus, Neanderthal man and Homo sapiens. Now they have missed out on a stage over here, which is present between Neanderthal man and Homo sapiens, and that is called as the Cro-Magnon man. I will tell you about that stage later on. Okay, and to this left side, when you see this first column here, they have basically mentioned different characters. For example, appearance, then site of the fossil record, where that fossil was found. How do we know that all these stages are present? Okay, how do we know that Dryopithecus was present, Dramopithecus was present, Australopithecus was present? Because their fossils were found in different areas. So where this fossil was found, that is there. Then period. Period means not when the fossil was found. Period means when that stage was present in evolution. Okay, during which epoch, during which era, during which period. So that is called as period. Okay, then skeletal features are the characters or the physical features, how the human being was shaped, okay, all those things. Then posture is given a separate character. Cranial capacity, which is very very important, please mark this. Okay, cranial capacity is very very important. All the values which are given, you should remember for your entrance exams. And then finally, special features, if any. Okay, the special feature of that stage. So let us start. The first stage in the evolution of man was called as Dryopithecus. Now please remember, this stage was called as the ape stage. Okay, so that means if you look at the photo of a Dryopithecus model, then you will not be able to recognize that it is actually one of the stages of human evolution. It looks like a small sized ape. So that is why this is also called as the ape stage. Please remember. Then slowly started the ape man stage, and then started the man stage. Are you getting this? Now, coming to the appearance, very very simple. Ape like appearance given over here. Okay. Now, site of fossil record. So that is where the fossil was found. So fossil was found in Lake Victoria of Africa. Okay, there are many areas where the fossils were found. Then it is also found in Himachal Pradesh. So if you can remember, try to remember at least one area where the fossil was found. Lake Victoria you can remember, or you can remember Himachal Pradesh. Okay, period is given. Okay, the time frame when that stage was present on earth. So it was present in Miocene epoch. Okay, please, again, period is very very important for all the entrance exam students to remember. You have to remember the periods of each of these stages. So Dryopithecus was present in Miocene epoch, which is approximately 20 to 25 million years ago. If you don't remember this million years ago, it's okay, please remember the name of the epoch. Then skeletal features, obviously enough fossils were not found, so we cannot actually describe how that stage looked. All right, posture is obviously going to be semi-erect, because it is an ape-like organism, so it is going to be semi-erect. Cranial capacity, again we don't know, because the fossil of the skull was not found. Okay, cranial capacity ke liye aapko skull ka fossil milna chahiye na. If you don't have the skull fossil, how will you estimate what was the size of the brain? So skull fossil was not found, so cranial capacity is not given over here. Special features they are asking, again looks very similar to a chimpanzee. So please remember, this first stage is very very similar to the apes. That is why it is called as ape stage. So nothing very important to remember over here. Please remember the sites where the fossil was found. So Dryopithecus first stage found near Lake Victoria and also in Himachal Pradesh. What was the period, or what was the time frame? Miocene epoch. Is this clear? Okay, cranial capacity you don't know, and any special features resembles closely to a chimpanzee. Then coming to the second stage, which is called as the Ramapithecus. Now please remember, the stages which are Ramapithecus and Australopithecus, both these stages are called as ape man stages. Okay, so ape man stage means that now that stage resembles an ape and it also resembles a man. Obviously, when you compare Ramapithecus with Australopithecus, Australopithecus looks more man like compared to Ramapithecus. Okay, so coming to Ramapithecus appearance, they are writing man like actually they should be writing ape man like okay. Site of fossil record, again one of the sites is in India, and it is Shivalik Hills in India, and it is also found in Kenya. So please remember, now in your book they have not given, there is a species which is called as Kenyapithecus. So that name is not given. So Ramapithecus and Kenyapithecus, the fossils which are found in Kenya, it is called as Kenyapithecus. It is not given in your book. All right, coming to the period, again it is Miocene. Okay, but now it is between Miocene and Pliocene. Alright, if you come to Dryopithecus, it is exactly Miocene epoch. Now, when you come to Ramapithecus, it is between Miocene and Pliocene epochs. So, it is present in both the epochs. So, here it is given Miocene and early Pliocene. Alright, again, skeletal features, we don't have enough fossil records, so we don't know how the organism looked. However, the posture has become erect over here. It has not become completely erect, but it is better than semi-erect. Then cranial capacity, again we don't know, no face, other special features. So again, nothing much to remember in Ramapithecus. Is this clear? Coming to the next stage, alright, which is called as Australopithecus. Now, Australopithecus is very, very important because Australopithecus is called as the connecting link. I'm going to write over here. Australopithecus is called as the connecting link between which groups? Connecting link between ape stage and man stage. Okay, so if you want, here I will write down, first comes the ape stage, which has obviously got Dryopithecus, then comes ape man stage, which has got Ramapithecus and Australopithecus, also Caniopithecus, and then comes the man stage. So in man stage, you can see the stages: Homo habilis, Homo erectus, Neanderthal man, Cro-Magnon man, Homo sapiens. So all these are man stage. Now, you can also say that Ramapithecus is also present between these two stages, but compared to the Ramapithecus, Australopithecus is actually a much developed stage. So that is why we call it as a connecting link. It connects the ape stage with the man stage, so it is present in between them. Are you getting this point? Okay, so that is about Australopithecus. It is the connecting link. Please remember, very, very important point. Then coming to the site of fossil record, so it was found in an area called as Tong in South Africa. I also know about the skull. So a skull cap was found. So the part of the fossil which was found, that was a skull cap. It is not given in the book, just extra information. All right. Also found in Ethiopia and Tanzania. Then period. So again, please remember. So it is very, very easy to remember. The first stage found in Miocene. Second stage found between Miocene and Pliocene. Now this next stage found between Pliocene and Pleistocene. So late Pliocene or early Pleistocene. So in that way you can remember the time frame. Okay. So present between Pliocene, late Pliocene and early Pleistocene epoch. Alright. Skeletal features, now for the first time they have given. Okay. So height is given. Height is approximately, they have given, okay, 4 feet. Okay. Not taller than 4 feet. So you can put that. Then jaws are larger. So you, I have already told you, it is a prognathous phase. The skull is sloping in the forward direction. So it is a prognathous phase. Chin is absent. Okay. And lumbar curvature is present. So lumbar curvature has started in which phase? It has started in Australopithecus. Please remember, again an MCQ can be asked. So in which stage was lumbar curvature found first? So lumbar curvature in the spine was first found in Australopithecus stage. Is this clear? So again, an important point. Then posture. Obviously, if the posture in Ramapithecus was erect, again in this stage the posture is going to be erect. So over here it is erect. Here they have given upright. It's almost the same thing. Then cranial capacity starts over here. Please guys, you have to remember these values. Okay, and among all the cranial capacities of the stages of man, this has the smallest capacity, and that capacity is how much? 450 to 600 cubic centimeters. Smallest cranial capacity. We have a cranial capacity of 1450 cubic centimeters. So you can say it is one third of our cranial capacity, or even lesser than that. Okay. And special features. So it is called as the man with ape brain. Again, very, very important point. I will write it down. Man with ape brain. What is the meaning of man with ape brain? See, this stage is called as the ape man stage. So the physical characteristics are like that of a man, but the brain is not very well developed. It is very, very small, like that of an ape. Okay, so that is why this stage is called as the man with an ape brain, because the size of the brain is much, much smaller. It is like the size of the brain of an ape. Are you clear? So, Australopithecus, please remember this stage. Alright, once again summarizing, connecting link between apes and man. Okay, where was the fossil found? Ethiopia, then Tong in South Africa, Tanzania. Alright, present between Pliocene and Pleistocene. Please remember, late Pliocene, early Pleistocene, present between these two stages. Then skeletal features, what are they? Prognathous jaws, alright, height not taller than 4 feet, lumbar curvature for the first time it has been present. Posture, you can write it as erect, upright, it is the same thing. Cranial capacity, very very important, first stage to actually show a proper cranial capacity, because the fossil was found 450 to 600 cc's and it is also called as man with the ape brain. Done. After this stage, all the other stages are called as man stages. Alright, so please remember, so we have finished with three stages of man. Now let us start with the next stage, which is called as Homo habilis. So now you can see that this word Homo comes in front of all the words. That means the stages are man stage. Alright, so let me write over here. Now we have begun with man stage and the first one is Homo habilis. Now I will tell you something. Homo habilis is commonly also called as the handyman. I will write down over here. Okay, what is the meaning of handyman? Now, it seems that these were the first men to make tools out of stones or wood. Okay, so first time in the history of evolution, the tools were made during this stage. So, handyman or the man who first made tools, Homo habilis. Is this clear? So this is the special feature of Homo habilis. Now let us start with the appearance. So as I told you, handyman, like the man who made tools, the site of fossil record. Now no need to remember this Olduvai gorge. Okay, you just remember Tanzania or you remember Africa, that's more than enough. Then coming to period, again the last period ended at Pleistocene. So now this will begin again. No, it's the same thing. Okay, so the period is same, it is again late Pliocene and early Pleistocene. So please remember, Australopithecus and Homo habilis have the same time frame. Now skeletal features, lower jaw. Okay, so now slowly the jaw is becoming orthognathous from prognathous. Then lightly built. Dentition, dentition means arrangement of the teeth is much more like us. Okay, and the molars are small. The stages which were before this stage, the stages which were before Homo habilis, they had an ape-like dentition where the molars were large. Okay, apes have bigger molars, human beings have smaller molars. So here the dentition is much more similar to human beings. Coming to the posture, again you can write upright or erect, it is the same thing. Cranial capacity is going to increase. So the cranial capacity I am going to write down over here, it is 650 to 800 cubic centimeters. So cc can also stand for cranial capacity, it can also stand for cubic centimeters. Is this clear? Special features is probably did not eat meat. Okay, so this is just an assumption that this stage did not eat meat, and very very important, made tools from stones, and that is why nicknamed handyman, which I have already told you. So the most important thing to remember about Homo habilis is the first stage to make tools out of stones, and probably it did not eat meat. So let me write down over here, did not. Now again, it is just an assumption. Okay, we do not know for sure whether this stage survived on meat or not, but over here it is given, and first man to make stone tools. Is this clear? Alright, this stage is called as Homo habilis, first stage in man stage. Is this clear? Alright, next we come to Homo erectus. Now Homo erectus, from the name we can make out that the posture of this stage was very very erect, so it was more or less like us. Okay, so from here the posture, the spinal posture, the walking posture became very very erect, and that is why this stage is called as Homo erectus. Now appearance over here, it is given as ape man, it is actually wrong. appearance looks like a man, okay, so that is a mistake in your textbook. It should not be ape man over here, it should be man-like. Sites where it is found. So now Homo erectus is again divided into two types. One is called as the Java man and the other is called as the pecking man. Okay, it is not given in the book. The names are given according to the fossils where they are found. If the fossil of Homo erectus was found in Java, it is called Java man. If it is found in Peking, Peking is a place in China, so then it is called as a pecking man. Okay, then coming to the period, now we are into the middle of Pleistocene epoch. Okay, before this we were in Pliocene and Pleistocene. Now we have come towards the middle of Pleistocene. Alright, so middle of Pleistocene. Now skeletal features, the height has definitely increased. So let me write down over here Homo erectus. Okay, all these skeletal features you should know. For example, you should know that Australopithecus was not taller than 4 feet. However, Homo erectus, now the height is up to 5 feet. So I will write down 5 feet height. Then prominent brow ridges. Brow ridges are these areas, okay, this bony area which is present near the bow, okay, low forehead, deep jaws, okay, chin is absent. So now again the skull is becoming prognathous, okay, it is not that earlier from prognathous it has become orthognathous, now it has become ortho, no. So that is why probably it is called as ape man stage, because the skull again has become like an ape, because the prognathous face is there, then massive jaws, okay, huge teeth, chin absent. So yeah, the skull of Homo erectus looks somewhat like an ape, so that is why they have called it as an ape man, but that is not a correct description. Okay, then coming to the posture, obviously erect, cranial capacity is 900 cubic centimeters, much more than Homo habilis. Okay, and finally special features. Now I will tell you one of the special features. It is thought that this was the first ape who first invented fire. That is what it is thought. So probably ate meat. Omnivorous. Omnivorous means can eat everything and might have used fire. So fire for the first time might have been used by Homo erectus. See, all these special features you have to remember. Questions can be asked. Might have first made use of fire. Is this clear? Okay, Homo erectus. Now coming to, we are now coming towards the end of the stages. Next stage is Neanderthal man. Now Neanderthal man is a very very evolved stage. Okay, and in Neanderthal man, so the description given is advanced prehistoric man. Okay, so very very similar to us, not as advanced as us, but very similar. Now again, where the site is, site of the fossil, now the name itself gives you the hint. It is in Neanderthal Valley in Germany. Okay, so see, most of the names of the stages are based on where the fossil is found. For example, Homo erectus, Peking man, Java man, fossil. Okay, then Ramapithecus, Kenyapithecus, based on where the fossil is found. So Neanderthal man is found in Neanderthal Valley in Germany. Now period, now we go towards the end of the Pleistocene. So it is late Pleistocene. This was middle Pleistocene, and before that it was early Pleistocene. Now skeletal features, very very strong and muscular, so heavily muscular. Again prominent brows, low forehead, deep jaws, chin is still absent. Remember, chin has not developed yet, and outwardly curved thigh bones. Okay, so the thigh bones are curved towards the outside. So that is one of the special features. So please remember, highly muscular. Okay, coming to the posture, obviously it will be erect. Cranial capacity was very very close to us. Okay, here they are mentioning 1400 cc, but in reality it was between 1410, okay, it was between 1410 to 1450 cc. Very very close to us. Our cranial capacity is 1450, theirs is 1400. So you can see that the brain is almost as developed as ours. And special features, use of clothing. So over here they have given used hide. Hide is what? Hide is dried leather. Okay, dried skin of animals. Buried their dead. So now customs and traditions have started. Burial, worshipping nature, worshipping God, all these things have started. Okay, so buried their dead, constructed flint tools. Flints are basically stones. Okay, And the tools made out of these flint, they are very, very sharp. So again, tool making is much more advanced. If you compare this with Homo habilis made tools only out of stones, but here they are making use of very sturdy and hard objects like flint. You must have heard of flintstones, right? So flintstones are stones which, when you rub with each other, they produce a spark and you can use it to make fire. Is this clear? So please remember, tradition customs have started in Nandarthal stage. Burial of dead, worshipping and use of flint to make more powerful tools. Okay, then they are present in Nandarthal Valley in Germany, and cranial capacity is 1400 cc, very, very near to our cranial capacity. Finally, coming to the last stage, that is our stage. Now, before this Homo sapiens stage, there is a stage which they have not given. It is called as the Cro-Magnon man. Now, this is pronounced as Cro-Magnon, okay, it is not Cro-Magnon. And the fossil was found in Cro-Magnon caves of France. I don't know why they have not given this stage. Now, one of the important features of this stage was, so the scientific name of this man is Homo sapiens fossilis. What is the meaning of fossilis? Fossilis means it is extinct. So this stage, Cro-Magnon stage, the people, all the human beings present in this stage, they were extinct approximately 10,000 to 40,000 years ago, not million, huh? Just 10,000 to 40,000 years ago, this stage became extinct, and since they are extinct, they are called Homo sapiens fossilis, very closely related to us, present between Neanderthal man stage and our stage, alright? So remember that. Another point about Cro-Magnon stage is the cranial capacity was the largest. It was even bigger than us, 1600 cubic centimeters. One of the reasons was they didn't have a much more developed brain compared to us. One of the reasons why the cranial capacity was more because they ate a lot of raw meat, and because of that they had to use their teeth a lot, and they needed a stronger skull. So the skull was bigger and stronger. Since the skull was bigger, the brain was also bigger. But a bigger brain doesn't mean that the organism is more intelligent, okay? So they had a bigger cranial capacity, and customs were followed, traditions were followed. They used to paint inside the caves, so very, very highly developed intellectual sense. Hunting was very developed, tools were very, very sharp, and they were much better compared to the tools made by Neanderthal man. So that is the stage called Cro-Magnon stage, not given in your book. Finally, after Cro-Magnon, we come to us. And we are called as Homo sapiens sapiens, or over here as given as Homo sapiens. We are the modern man. So fossils, the first fossil of Homo sapiens was found in Africa. So you know the period, I'm not going to write the current period which is going on. Skeletal features, all the features that we have, posture is erect. Cranial capacity, please remember, our cranial capacity is 1450, and we are also called as the modern man. Please remember this, guys. Okay, special features, many different races, African, Asian, Ethiopian, many different races have developed, and developed cave art. Okay, so cave art, as I told you, was developed by Cro-Magnon man. Okay, and then it continued into us. Here it is given that developed cave art about 18,000 years ago, but 18,000 years ago Cro-Magnon man was present. So here they are considering Cro-Magnon man and us as the same thing. No, they are not. So Cro-Magnon man invented cave art. Is this clear? So with that, we have finished with this entire part of evolution of man. Okay, this chart is very, very important for all those who are giving entrance exams. So please, guys, remember the special features, cranial capacity, posture is very simple. Only the first stage is having a semi-erect posture. All of the others, only Dryopithecus is having semi-erect posture. All the other stages are having an erect posture. Skeletal features, if you can remember, it will be good. Coming to the periods, we start with Miocene. Then we go into Miocene and Pliocene. Then we go into Pliocene and Pleistocene for two stages. And then we go into Middle Pleistocene and Late Pleistocene. So you don't have to remember too many names. Site of fossil record, again, most of the fossils are giving the name to the stage. Okay, Dryopithecus was found in Himachal and Lake Victoria. रामापिथिकस वॉज फाउंड इन केनिया, शिवालिक हिल्स केनिया वाला जो फॉसिल इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड केनिया पिथिकस। ऑस्ट्रेलोपिथिकस फाउंड इन टोंग इन साउथ अफ्रीका, इथोपिया तांजानिया। होमो हैबिलिस फाउंड इन अफ्रीका। होमो इरेक्टस जावा एंड पेकिंग, आई कॉल्ड यू जावा मैन, आई टोल्ड यू जावा मैन एंड पेकिंग मैन। नेंदरथल मैन, नेंदरथल वैली जर्मनी। क्रोमैनियन मैन, क्रोमैनियन केव्स इन फ्रांस। एंड अस, फर्स्ट फॉसिल फाउंड इन अफ्रीका। इज दिस क्लियर? सो वी हैव एंडेड दैट पार्ट। एंड मैन इज हाईली डेवलप्ड, ओके, एंड बिकॉज ऑफ ऑल दी स्पेशल फीचर्स, द कोऑर्डिनेशन ऑफ द ब्रेन विद द अदर ऑर्गन्स इज मच मोर एडवांस्ड व्हेन कंपेयर्ड टू ऑल द अदर ऑर्गेनिजम्स। ओके, सो गाइज, दैट एंड्स अवर लेक्चर ओवर हियर, दैट एंड्स योर चैप्टर। ओके, मोस्ट ऑफ द पार्ट्स फ्रॉम दिस चैप्टर हैव बीन डिलीटेड फॉर दिस एकेडमिक ईयर। सो दिस एंड्स अवर चैप्टर ऑफ इवोल्यूशन। ओके, एंड दैट एंड्स अवर पार्ट ऑफ ह्यूमन इवोल्यूशन। गाइज, इफ यू हैव नॉट सब्सक्राइब टू माई चैनल, काइंडली सब्सक्राइब, शेयर द वीडियोज, एंड इफ यू थिंक दैट दीज वीडियोज आर हेल्पिंग यू, प्लीज लाइक देम, पोस्ट अ कमेंट। ऑल राइट, एंड थैंक्स अ लॉट।